Hi, I'm Deirdre Connolly with SandboxAQ. I'm a standardization research engineer here in the cybersecurity group. And today I have Dan Lenski with me. Hi, Dan.
Hello.
I wanted to talk to you today because you are about to release a new set of research that you've done scanning the internet for cryptographic keys, and specifically weak keys and just general characteristics of openly available cryptographic keys on the internet.
Right.
I know that there was some sort of research done in a similar vein like 8 to 10 years ago, but you've developed kind of newer techniques to get more keys and reach even farther than we were before. Can you tell me a little bit about what you did?
Yeah. So the research from 2012 to 2016 that you're referring to looked in particular at RSA keys and their factorability was a major topic of research. So part of what motivated this work was to repeat that and see if we could find some of the same vulnerabilities in RSA keys. But additionally, we wanted to look for more sources of long-term public keys on the internet, ranging from TLS to SSH user and host keys and others, and see if we could see any new vulnerabilities or patterns that have emerged.
Cool. Some of the other keys that you found were long-lived keys that were generated by buggy software in Debian almost 20 years ago.
Right.
Can you tell us about these weak Debian keys?
Yeah. So from 2006 to 2008, Debian and all of the many derivative Linux distributions distributed a version of OpenSSL and of the OpenSSH key generating software, which had grossly insufficient entropy that was essentially only seeded by a 15-bit quantity, the process identifier. And as a result, when this was discovered, it was realized that for anybody generating a key, which is supposed to have hundreds of bits of randomness in it, at least, that there was really only 15 bits of randomness, which meant the entire set of keys could be generated and enumerated, not just the public keys, but the private keys along with them. And so this was obviously a major vulnerability, and these had been quite widely used. And there was a very concerted effort starting in 2008 to identify these and remove them, ban them, eradicate them. So it's pretty striking to find that there are still some of them in use 16 years later.
They're on these hosts. They are on some of these Git-based hosting sites, and they're using these weak keys that were generated almost 20 years ago, because that's when that software was deprecated and rolled off.
Yes.
As their SSH user keys, including at least two highly active users, which means their identities can be trivially forged on these platforms.
Right. So I think it's important that there be some form of responsible disclosure to the platforms and the users about their existence. I also think that the platforms that allow users to enroll SSH keys need to do a substantially better job of validating them and sanity checking them. There are only, depending on how you count, couple hundred thousand possible variants of these Debian weak keys, and I think it's well worth the small amount of effort to compare against them, hash against them.
You also identified plenty of reusing those SSH keys by users and by servers.
Yes.
Why is that dangerous?
It's likely that the way that users protect their individual identifying keys and their server keys are different from each other. For example, a server key could be shared among the administrators of a system, while a user key is generally assumed to be identifying of a single user. I think that the fact that these user and host keys are reused is probably a user interface or user experience failure, where sites like GitHub or GitLab say, here's a form, you need to upload your SSH key, go find a key file called SSH-RSA or SSH-ED25519 on your system and copy its contents in here, without realizing that the host key and the user key will both have that name. And if you don't know exactly where to look for it, you may find the wrong one.
One of the things that was almost a limitation of your current iteration of your work is that there's a lot of certificates out on the internet that people use to connect via TLS,
right?
That aren't in the TLS log, the certificate transparency yes. logs, which is to their detriment because basically for modern certificates, they have to be in the logs for certain browsers and servers to actually make the connection. Their SCTs have to be validated to
right.
do so. But you were able to find lots of really good keys
yeah.
in the certificate transparency logs, but it seems that that is a function of it's a leading edge of keys.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's both a function of the fact that it's a leading edge and that we were essentially only looking at the fire hose of recent keys and certificates being logged to the certificate transparency logs.
Right.
If we had more time and bandwidth, we could go back further in time and look at the first few months of the CT logs operating, for example, and might find a different result. But I also think that it's a result of the publicity and shining a bright light effect that the certificate transparency logs have, which is that certificate authorities, CAs, seem to be more careful about the certificates they validate and sign as a result of the CT logs creating a provable history
yeah.
of what they have signed.
Part of the novelty of your work is that you were able to not just get whatever key material the server, the SSH server or TLS server offered you on first try,
right.
but you were able to kind of enumerate it all the way down
yes.
to the lowest grade it could offer you. Can you talk a little bit about how you did that work or what made that work?
Absolutely. So when you look at some of the commercial databases that have enumerated and scanned TLS and the SSH servers, you'll see that typically they only show you one key or one certificate for a given point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And this is probably most apparent for SSH servers because SSH servers often have this cascade of compatibility
mm-hmm.
where the host will have an ED25519 key, modern elliptic curve based, considered secure. They may have an RSA key. They may have a DSA key as well, a much older and basically obsolescent standard. But for a modern client, they will only use the ED25519 key in verifying the server's identity.
Mm.
So what I realized is that with a little bit of tweaking of some existing libraries for this, we could get the scanning client to present itself as progressively older or less capable clients and thereby discover some of these older and potentially abandoned or forgotten keys. We discovered some examples of keys that would have been considered only marginally secure 15 or 20 years ago. There seems to be a very long half-life of insecure keys on the internet, and so it seems important to be more aggressive in deprecating mm-hmm. the older ones.
Yeah. You mentioned that some of these RSA key generators had weird exponents. They had like very, you know, distinct little keys. Why do you think DNSSEC seemed to have a very particular hard time with this?
So DNSSEC is an approach, is a technology that's used to secure the domain name system that's very fundamental to the modern internet. And DNSSEC is a set of protocols and technologies that are supposed to cryptographically assure the domain name system.
Mm-hmm.
It's been developed over the course of several decades, and it has been somewhat widely adopted, but not really enforced, meaning that there are many domain names which publish DNSSEC keys, which could be used to cryptographically validate the DNS records, but there are almost no clients that actually enforce those requirements.
Mm.
So I think that to some degree, DNSSEC has become a box checking exercise
mm-hmm.
where administrators use it and generate it, but never actually validate that it's doing what it says it should.
That's a bummer. Can you talk a little bit about why the sort of like privacy leak, you could call it a privacy leak of exactly how you're generating your keys and with what tools? Is so dangerous.
Yeah. I would say in general, it's important to use modern and secure cryptography.
Mm-hmm.
So you shouldn't be using 512-bit RSA keys just because you have been for the last 20 years. Mm-hmm. So it would be more appropriate to choose a 4096-bit RSA key or an EC key, for example. But at the same time, you don't want to pick something new just because it looks exciting and futuristic. Mm-hmm. Because if you generate your keys in a way that causes them to stand out, that allows attackers to potentially identify them as originating from a specific rare piece of software. Mm-hmm. So to give you a more specific example, most RSA keys use the exponent of 65,537, but ones from older versions of OpenSSH and older versions of PuTTY instead use the exponents of 35 and 37. Now, there are millions of such keys out there, and as far as we know, they are just as secure as the keys with the standard exponent. But. However, if anybody were to discover some heretofore unknown vulnerability in an older version of PuTTY, for example, they could immediately identify millions of keys to target for further attacks.
Yeah.
So you really don't want to stand out from the crowd. We have no reason to think that those are insecure cryptographically at all. However, it's very clear that because those are used in such small numbers, we can infer a lot of information about, for example, what kind of server is offering those keys or where it's geographically located because it uses these particular algorithms. So this might, again, be an illustration of why even the latest and greatest cryptography, technically speaking, you may not want to stand out from the crowd so much in choosing something that's unusual.
Yeah, and this is the sort of stuff that like we detect for you in Sandbox's Active Guard. Like we're trying to suck in all of your cryptographic data about what you're using in your production and to tell you that, oh, you're secretly using DSA keys on your SSH server, or you're secretly using, you know, a crap TLS certificate that, you know, this is like a big like red warning here.
Right.
This is exactly the sort of thing that we flag for you with ActiveGuard.
Right.
So, yeah. Thank you so much, Dan.
Yeah, my pleasure.